Thousands of black people felt the victory and saw James Meredith as an example to follow, a symbol like the Little Rock Nine of their own power to move the nation.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Meredith.
You all cut that part out. But
it wasn't in there. I know what you're talking about.
The first thing that Governor Boris Barnett said, which one of you is James Meredith? Yeah. Now, you understand.
I was looking for it.
That was the second time he'd done that joke. And he later told my wife that he did it that time, which you didn't show, because it came over so big the first time when there wasn't no TV camera. He had to do it before the camera. I'm certainly sure, although he never told me this, but I'm almost positive that most of the shenanigans that Governor Barnett pulled off was designed to protect the black people in Mississippi. I mean, because like when he called them, all of the law officers, officials, all of them called Jackson to protect him from the feds. He knew the feds wasn't coming to arrest him. What he really wanted all those sheriffs and other people to do was to come where he could watch over them so they wouldn't take things in their own hand and mistreat blacks all over the state. Now, so, I mean, I have long believed that most whites were as dissatisfied with the status quo as any black.
Now, you also sought out the NAACP and wrote a letter to then Thurgood Marshall. Why did you seek their involvement? Was this just legal protection at this point?
Well, basically, that was Mega Evers. He wanted to get the NAACP involved, and he almost got real big trouble because, you know, the NAACP is one thing, the NAACP League of Defense Fund is another. And he didn't contact the NAACP lawyer. He contacted Thurgood Marshall, which was a different group. And so that's how that came about.
Although Thurgood Marshall remarked that this man has got to be crazy to challenge Mississippi officials, he assigned the case to Constance Baker Motley, who we saw in the film.
If I had to credit one single person for making things happen, it was her. Because well, she not only was a woman, she was a brilliant woman. I mean, she knew how to get what she wanted out of me. And I don't think nobody else could have done that. All of those things that you see in the movie were nothing but games. And I knew they were games. You understand that? I mean, that was to get control of the population. I mean, I never would have gone to Ole Miss if I hadn't known that the Kennedys was going to send the 101st and the 82nd and all them other crack troops, you understand? Without that commitment, which they didn't want to make because it was then hoping to be a second term president. So, I mean, but you understand, I mean, without my personal knowledge, that the military was not only on alert, but was coming, I would have never went. You see, my belief always is a good soldier ain't never a dead soldier. A good soldier is one that's always around to fight.
Did they let you know that they were ready to use the troops?
You better believe it or I wouldn't have went.
Did you fear for yourself?
Well, you know, I don't know really how to answer that. I mean, because fear got to, you see, philosophy is really important. Now, I had fear, but my only fear was not being successful in accomplishing my mission. And my mission was to live. As far as I was concerned, I'd been dead all my life. If I hadn't been dead, I wouldn't have got behind the black curtain on the Greyhound bus. You understand? I was a dead man. I was fighting to live. So most people talk about fear. They're talking about dying, living. That didn't mean much to me. I mean that because... you know, I have believed, you see, before I went into the Air Force, as a senior in high school, the American Legion had a contest, Why I'm Proud to Be an American. And I entered that contest and won. Now, because I really believe that America, and my theory was, I'm not proud of being America for what it is, but for what it can become. And I really believe that. And I still believe that, and it ain't there yet. Don't want nobody to get that idea. But I genuinely believe that.
1962, and you actually go and meet Registrar Ellis. What were you thinking? If all of a sudden I handed you a pen and said, you've done it.
I was thinking that the Registrar Ellis was the only man on the campus with spirit. I mean, in spite of him saying register.
Did your paths cross with Ross Barnett afterwards?
Oh, many, many times. I mean, as a matter of fact, it was not. I'd like to thank you for the best restaurant in Mississippi, the LaFleur's restaurant. And I never seen him when he didn't shake my hand, not once. My goal was to make every black boy feel like that he was superior to me, and if old Jane Meredith can make it, I can make it. And it literally turned out that way. Everybody felt sorry and pity but James Meredith. For one time, they was talking about how I was gonna fail, and I encouraged it to the hilt. You understand? Because, first of all, I think I made one B. But it was very important for the mass of the people to think that there's this struggling, scuffling James Meredith. And then when I make it, oh boy. And it has, I'm pretty sure it turned out that way. I don't want to take credit, but I know that was my goal. But the most significant thing that I think has happened in my life was October last year at the University of Mississippi, when they put up a statue of James Meredith between the Lyceum building, which is not only well known, but gonna be known for a long time, and the library. Because I don't know exactly what it means. I don't have no good reason to believe that the university even know what they intended to try to do. But I consider it the most significant thing, not really for me, but for the black-white race issue in America.
Your sharing these stories with us has been extra special. Ladies and gentlemen, James Meredith.